Good evening, everybody. Can you hear me? Like, do I need the microphone or is it fine like this? Fine like this?
That's much easier for me.
Well, good evening, everybody. Thanks for coming here. I'm Andrea Musso. Some of you already know me. Well, I'm the president of SysQLB, which is the association together also with Milano that proposed the event of tonight. What SIT does, basically SIT is a student association formed by polytechnical students, mainly from management engineering, and we propose these kind of activities, so like events, so like conferences, debates, also trips, to like share all along the university the themes of the social innovation and sustainable development. Together with that, we also propose projects. For example, there's one ongoing right now, which involves urban forestation in the Bovisa campus, and it will see its beginning in like the next 2 months, and we will also update you for the like the next steps of the project. And we are part of a community, like a wider community. It's like SIT, social innovation teams, and our goal is to become the widest, largest social innovation community around Italy. And all the association, we have other SIT Polytechnico in Torino, Torino, we share like, all the same values and goals. Well, let's switch to the event of tonight. It will have like a scheme of the round table, and me together with Nicolo, we'll moderate, stimulate the discussion with some questions, and we'll try to cover all the different aspects of the plastics role in circular economy. So we'll first of all understand like the role of plastics in the value chain, and also the barriers, drivers, and all the factors that like are enabling or are impeding the transition towards a more like more circular economy, in contrast like with the traditional linear one. And this will be done with the help of our guest speakers that will also use some practical examples coming like from their everyday working life. Now I leave the stage to Nicolò, which will introduce to you the speakers. Thank you.
So good evening, everybody. Concerning the proposed topic, we have decided to invite like heterogeneous actors who work in the plastic field. So in order to ensure like a more balanced discussion and a more balanced roundtable. So from your left side to the right side, there's Mr. Antonio Protopapa. Thanks for joining us. Research and Development Director of Corepla. Corepla is a national consortium for collection, recycling, and recovery of plastic packaging. Then we have Mr. Christian Barsky. He represents Campus Sostenibile. Campus Sostenibile project was launched in 2011 and is promoted by Politecnico di Milano and aims to transform the university district into a campus and a part of the city that becomes more equity and more sustainable and kind of accessible for everybody. Then we have Ms. Giulia Giglio, in Innovation Manager at Field Design Milano. Design is an innovative startup that produces lamps using recycled plastic with 3D printers. Then we have Mr. Giovanni Lococo, freelancer and passionate about sustainability and climate change issues and art as well. Exactly. And then we have Mr. Stefano Richaud, Chief Executive Officer of Ecoplastin. Ecoplastin is a company that through technology development and sustainability implement process for the end of the waste of polylaminates and generate a new 100% product, which is recycling. So we have a few questions for you, but if in the meantime you want to introduce yourself, you can do it, otherwise we can go forward with the question. And go with the question. Okay, so question first one. In the past years, we heard more and more about the ideas of circular economy and sustainable development, also inspired to the sustainable development goals of the United Nations. So within this framework, how do you see plastic, including recycled materials and bioplastic, making the transition to circularity possible from production to second life for recycled plastic? Negli ultimi anni ci sempre più idee su economia circolare, sviluppo sostenibile, ispirati anche principalmente a quelli che sono stati gli obiettivi di sviluppo sostenibile che sono stati promossi dalla Nazione. Quindi, in questo contesto, in questo quadro, qual è la vostra opinione su quelle che sono ora le materie plastiche, compresi i materiali riciclati di plastiche, che possono rendere questa transizione verso la circolarità possibile e garantire una seconda vita per quelle che sono le materie plastiche riciclate? If any one of you want to start and talk about it.
Okay. Good evening. Can you hear me from the audience? Okay. That seems to be an easy question to ask, but of course to reply and to give a proper answer, it will take roughly a couple of days. So I try to shrink them in 5 minutes. First of all, you have to consider what the plastics have done for our life, for our health, for our style of living today in the last 50 years, in a way that maybe most of us tend to underestimate. If I will take out the plastic from this room, I think we will be sitting on the floor with some problems, possibly half naked. Your mobile phone, your computers, whatever is around you will disappear. So we need to consider what plastics have done for us and what continue to do for us. Today in the world we have a total consumption of plastics which is around 360 million tons. It's a huge amount of material that we use for all applications. You can start from packaging, which is the most important application. We can move to the building, construction, appliances, automotive, household stuff. So it's just glass. So maybe half of you will be in trouble. I'm having my contact lens made of plastics. And of course, the opportunity for this material to continue to represent the choice for many applications will be there also in the near future. The real problem, the real issue that we have with plastics is the end of life of the goods made of plastics. But the end of life problem does not rely only in plastics, it relies and stays for all the materials. Because if we take glass, aluminium, or all the other stuff that we are using sometimes to replace, I see a lot of aluminium stuff here, to replace the plastic, if they are left in the environment, they will not disappear, neither in 1 year, nor in 15, nor in 50, not even in a century. So what is more important to discuss is how we manage the end of life. And replying to what is the first question regarding circular economy, one of the key issues to manage the end of life is to design the materials and to design the property, having in mind also the end of life. We are in a school where most of the people are engineers or will become engineers. Everybody knows what design means for an engineer. Until now, or until a few years ago, designing a material, designing a product was made in order to respond to performance, to cost, to effectiveness, to reliability, to duration. And now we need to add an extra item, which is the end of life management. End of life can be, of course, when for a packaging we consume a good and will become a waste in minutes. So if we take just a bottle of mineral water, the life will be just a few weeks. If I buy a car, maybe the bumpers of the car will be lasting 10, 15 years, but still I have a problem when this car will be destroyed and I need to change it with the new ones, and I have the bumper or other plastic stuff to take care of. And for any other things, appliances and so on, we need to really take care of the end of life. And this is the most important change in the design. So what people call eco design, it's the fact that when we design a new product, we need to consider what happens also at the end of life. Regarding the most important application for plastics, which is packaging, the packaging producers have already started to think about what will be the end of life of the packaging. They're already taking care of it. And maybe in the next intervention, I will give you some more details about what Italy and Europe are doing for recovering and recycling plastic packaging.
Thank you. Thank you. Okay.
Yes, I agree with Mr. Potopapa. Plastics are not the problem. The problem is in which way we toss it. You know that about 90% of plastics in the ocean, the marine litter, coming from 10 rivers in the world, all of them located in Asia or Africa, where recycling education, there is a recycling education where we have to put our plastic and to do a collection in a different way. The plastic is something really important in our industry, in our economy, because the application are really large number. And so we have to find a solution of recycling and to do a circular economy with the reusing of this material. For instance, in our project, in our company, we find a solution of the most difficult waste composed of the different layers of materials, as plastic, cellulose, and lean. So if we find a solution of this polylaminate material, we have to find a solution of all kind of plastic. So a reuse and a circular economy. No waste in this is a solution.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Would you like to add something?
Okay. Io ho un problema con l'inglese, per cui perdonatemi, parlerò in italiano. Dunque, io non credo che questo lo dico da innovation manager di un'azienda nella quale sono entrata tra l'altro da poco, per cui mi sto educando alla gestione dei rifiuti, di cosa considerare rifiuti, all'economia circolare, una serie di temi su quali mi rendo conto di non essere stata educata ed informata adeguatamente fino ad ottobre di quest'anno. Parliamo di plastica, ma possiamo parlare anche dei rifiuti organici, cioè tutti quei rifiuti che derivano dai processi produttivi, dei processi alimentari, cioè tutto quello che noi buttiamo nel liquido. Due dati. Senza ammorbarvi chiaramente, 1,3 miliardi all'anno vengono prodotti di scarto alimentare, che corrispondono tra l'altro a 3,3 miliardi di emissioni in CO2, pari all'8% circa delle emissioni globali. Questo significa che la gestione e lo smaltimento dei rifiuti organici ha un impatto e dei costi non soltanto in termini monetari sulla per noi che siamo la collettività, per l'ambiente in cui viviamo e in una certa parte anche per le aziende. Quindi questo cosa significa? Significa che non diamo valore in realtà ad una risorsa esistente. La società per la quale lavoro, Grid Design, che è una startup milanese che spento quest'anno la prima candelina, è stata fondata l'anno scorso, in realtà come mission e come vision anche, secondo me, quella di ridare valore ad uno scarto, generando dallo scarto organico una nuova materia prima che può essere introdotta all'interno del sistema produttivo sotto forma di oggetti di ecodesign. Quindi non generare nulla di nuovo, ma prendere quello che è esistente, quindi uno scarto, e ritrasformarlo in qualcosa di bello. Questo processo permette anche la creazione di una bioplastica, perché avviene un processo di facciamo un biopolimero dalla polverizzazione di questi scarti che arricchiscono il PLA, quindi l'acido polilattico, e che si prestano tra l'altro alla tecnologia di stampa 3D, quindi alla manifattura digitale, con la quale si può creare e si possono ideare una serie di oggetti stampati in maniera responsabile, quindi sostenibile, perché vengono stampati on demand, cioè su richiesta specifica del cliente. Io, quando ho sentito parlare di questo progetto, mi sono innamorata, arrivavo da tutto altro settore, perché credo sia veramente importante creare una sensibilizzazione sul problema, non solo della plastica, ma anche degli scarti organici, e guardarli anche da un'altra prospettiva, una prospettiva che da rifiuto in realtà si può creare valore e creare anche oggetti con cui possiamo arredare ad esempio le nostre case. Questo è un po' quello che volevo aggiungere rispetto al problema specifico della plastica.
Thank you very much. Really nice.
All right. I'll continue in English. I want to refer to the 10 rivers, the biggest polluting rivers. I completely agree that we need to pay attention to that aspect. But where I grew up, the first thing was, if we want a better environment, if we want to change something, we start looking in the mirror. So we look at the mirror and we see a university with 47,000 students that study in 6 different cities, most of them in Milan, but there are also people in Como, in Lecco, in Cremona, in Mantova, in Piacenza. Not only students, but also almost 5,000 employees. What do they do every day? They go to a vending machine and they buy a bottle of plastic water, or bottle of water in single-use plastic that they buy, they use, and they toss. To indicate a number of that, that's about 800,000 bottles per year. The problem is that this trend is not really decreasing, despite the fact that we're all using these nice aluminium bottles. Here in Bovisa, the trend is slightly decreasing, but in the other campus, in Leonardo, there's no decrease really visible. So are we changing here? Are we doing something better? Plastic cups. The ones that we students, or I was a student a year ago, use every morning to wake up. 1.2 hot drinks per student per day, about 10,000 students in campus, brings me to exemplify. If I put a WhatsApp message and I send it to you, I put the emoji of the plastic cup. I can put 11 in a row, 21. In the length of the screen. And if I send this message to you of the cups that are used only today, you'll be 53 times scrolling just to scroll through the use of today, just to give you an image of the quantity that's being tossed every day.
Really impressive numbers that, like, for your intervention, it's like education, personal education of people could really like play an important role. I would like to like what Mr. Produava said about also interventions from like policymakers. I was thinking about the plastic tax. Many of you are familiar with next year plastic tax, and I would like to ask you, like, how, like, policy can also, like, play a role in this transition. Do you think it's important? Do you think it's easy, transaction.
Okay. First of all, let me just put the things in the perspective. We were talking about 800,000 PET bottles used in a year, if I understand well, in your campus. Okay, in Italy, the total consumption of PET bottles for mineral water and soft drink is 15 billion. Okay, 15 billion per annum. What happens? 10 billion of these bottles are recycled. So what is important is to put everything in perspective. Of course, every campus, every location, every place can give a contribution. But even more important is to know that if we act and behave properly, even a plastic bottle can become a resource, can be recycled and become a new material. Maybe to reproduce the bottle again, or to produce something else. Recycling products have nothing to compare, of course, in terms of performance with some raw materials, which are so-called virgin material. But in many other cases, also recycled product today can be comparable with the virgin material. What is important is what happens with the 5 billion that are not yet recycled. For sure, they're not ending up in our sea, in our river, in our oceans, apart a minor quantity, which do not go to the river, to the sea, to the lakes on their own. There is always a human behavior, which is throwing away the bottle, leaving it into the environment. And suddenly, of course, this becomes an issue and a problem. So this just to give you a reference in terms of number. If we talk about the plastic cups, in Italy, we are lover and I will say even dependent in some cases from coffee. When we are traveling abroad, one of the main problems we face is to find someone who gives us a good espresso, and you will hear Italians, you know, talking and discussing, there is not a bar here, I cannot have an espresso. So that is a real issue for an Italian traveling. But in Italy, luckily we have bar, but we also have the vending machine. Vending machines are distributed all over the country, and today they represent the most important supplier of coffee for people during the day. Nobody knows, but we have more than 800,000 vending machines distributed in Italy. And what they do, they have 25 million customers, all of us, 25 million out of 60 million of Italians use vending machine more or less regularly. And we consume 5 billion coffee per annum. Every coffee means a cup. So easy to say, we have 5 billion cups. Why I'm giving you these numbers? You have to put the problem in perspective. We need to know what is the amount of material that we use for our daily life and which are the potential alternatives that we could use. So, of course, we can replace 15 billion bottles made in PET with nice glass bottles, for example. So imagine 15 billion bottles of plastic, of glass traveling around Italy with mineral water inside. The impact they have in terms of CO2 to produce them, CO2 for transport, and also the heaviness that we have when we have to bring them at home, okay? So it's important that you understand the size. Now, coming back to bioplastics, I skipped partially the question regarding bioplastics. Let's make some clarity about these materials. First of all, with bioplastics, we include so many materials, but in principle, we can divide them in three major families. Bioplastic made with renewable raw materials, but not biodegradable and not compostable. Bioplastic made with renewable material, also biodegradable and compostable, and bioplastic made with renewable no materials at not compostable. So when you have this three family, you include basically all the bioplastics produced in the world. There is anybody of you who knows which is the global capacity of bioplastics all included, so the three families I was saying before, on a global basis? It's 1% of the total demand. 360 million of fossil-based plastics, 3 million tons bioplastics all included. If we take only the so-called biodegradable and compostable, it's less than 1.5 million. So they are not the solution for our problem. They are one of the solution. They have a role. Welcome to have polymers made with our waste, because this is a contribution to the circularity of our life. But don't be, don't expect that the bioplastics is the solution to replace the standard plastic that we have today. Fossil-based plastics is growing at 3.5% on an annual basis. So means that this year versus next year, we have a consumption increasing by 10 million tons. The total capacity of bioplastics will increase, let's assume 20%, so means 600,000. We still are missing 9.5. Another important point is we should not, of course, consider bioplastic the solution for the marine litter problem, because bioplastics are not biodegradable in the environment. If you take a plastic material, say a glass or a bottle, made with PLA or even with the Matter B, which are the two major players in this market, and you leave them in the environment, they will stay there for years. Okay? To destroy them, you need compostable plants where there is the right temperature, the right humidity, and are the right microorganisms to really biodegrade them in a proper way. So this is not the solution for the marine litter again. The solution for the marine litter is, first of all, the human behavior, mainly in the so-called rich part of the world. But more important is to give the structures to build up the plants to have the waste collection in the growing part of the world. All the Far East and African countries still have a lack of plant for managing their waste, not the plastic waste, their waste, the total waste that they produce. Of course, plastics is the most visible for the simple fact that it's the lighter material, easy to replace anything else, and so it's also easy to find them in the environment. Again, just to give you an example, in 1 ton of plastics, you can have up to 40,000 PET bottles, because a PET bottle is weighing only 25 grams. So this is the volume and the size that you have when just 1 ton of material is just generated as a waste. Coming to the plastic tax, this I think it's the daily discussion in Rome. And Italy, in this case, is trying to lead Europe with an approach which has nothing to do with the environment. Plastic tax, it's simply a tax. And normally, when you have a tax in place, you expect this tax to give you something back in terms of service or in terms of benefit. If you pay your standard tax, you have school, you have administration service, and so on, waste management. In this case, it's only to create, to generate cash to cover our debts. So the industry, at all level, I will say, never seen all the industry so really compact against this tax because there is no benefit expected, and they will only increase the cost for our goods because, of course, the consumer at the end will pay for it.
The industry and the consumer.
The industry normally makes profit out of this business. If they see something that is increasing their cost, they will simply pass the cost to the consumer. So at the very end, will be us buying our material, our products in a packaging to pay the bill for this tax, as usual happens in this case. We see other options to really generate a positive approach versus the environment. And this is mainly related to education, it's related to communication, it's related to behavior of the people and behavior of the companies. And I will touch this later on.
Okay. Anyone who wants to reply back about plastic tax or generally the role of the market regulation?
Sì, volevo un po' agganciarmi al discorso. Chiaro che la bioplastica è vero, non è una soluzione, ne sono sicura. Quello che è la soluzione è il cambio di educazione, di formazione all'utilizzo di determinati, all'utilizzo, alla gestione dei nostri, di quello che consumiamo, di quello che acquistiamo. Ma secondo lei l'economia circolare invece potrebbe essere in questo senso una soluzione educativa, quindi cominciare a parlare veramente, ma io non parlo soltanto a livello locale, parlo di istituzioni, a parlare veramente di economia circolare e diciamo creare un circolo virtuoso che permetta di renderla di uso comune, di gestione comune.
Circular economy is on the table of the European Parliament since 5 years and has become popular in let's say at our level in the last couple of years because has been in a way used for discussing about waste management. Circular economy is not waste management. Waste management is something that deals with the end of life. There are experts, there are companies doing this, there are a lot of business around waste management who are doing their job. Circular economy is a revolution in terms of how we think about our economy. It's not just something to, it's not just something to do with the environment or with the end of life. It's all the process that have to change. And in the process, of course, there is the behavior of the consumers, of the citizens, but there is a big and important change in the approach of the producers. If you think, for example, what has happened in the appliances. When I was young, some years ago, and you bought a television set or a washing machine, it could last 10, 15, 20 years, maybe with some problems, some will be repairing it, adjusting, finally finding a solution for minor problems. And we believed that that machine could last for 15, 20, 25 years without problem. If you buy a television set today, it will last more than 5 years. There is a kind of deadline in the design of that TV set that will or not be any more useful because it will not be able to support the evolution of the technology. If you think the smart TV that we have bought 3 years ago, today are useless. In 2 years' time, someone will change again the system to show the program, to broadcast the programs. I'm not mentioning the cellular phone, the mobile phones, because this is
2 years
in the old. I bought mine 2 or 3 years ago. Today, I'm not able even to use it anymore. Not only, we cannot find a way to charge the phone anymore because if you move from iPhone 6 or 7 to iPhone, I don't know, 10 or 11, they change the system to charge them. This is not a circular economy. This is the exactly opposite or what circular economy means. Because at the end, you end up with a cable, a charger, maybe a phone that you don't know what to do with. And there is no way to recover it. If you go to Apple and give them back, you will get 20 euro. You paid 500 when you bought 2 years before. So coming back to the original demand question, when we talk about circularity in our economy, we do not need to concentrate only on the end of life, on the waste part. We need to work on the whole cycle life of the material, of the product, of the packaging, of the goods that we are designing. And those of you who will be engaged in designing products, even houses or bridges, today it's very popular in Italy, when I made the Scienza delle Costruzioni roughly 40 years ago, I learned a lot of things about cement and all this stuff, which today are absolutely not true anymore. We see that if you do not do properly your design, you have a problem also in building and construction. So to close the concept of circular economy, forget about the end of life. Don't concentrate your attention like the media do on the waste management. Waste is only the last part of it. You have to look at the full life cycle of products and goods.
Yeah. I also agree, if I can take the word for a second. Very important to look at the whole life of the product, starting from the design, from the material, the use, and how things can be designed in a different way that the end of the product will not be the end, maybe. A practical example, the initiative why I'm sitting here comes from the recycling of used bicycle tires. And I say used bicycle tires because I cannot call them waste. If I call them waste, I cannot touch them anymore. There are so many rules, there are so many regulations on the word waste. So then I completely follow my colleague on my right, on your left, that don't think about the waste concept. Also in a lot of policy, it becomes a very heavy, a very spoken about, a very important theme. But I think, and certainly in the university and in a process where we can still work and think and design on the previous phases, that we should concentrate on these parts of circular economy. So waste is the last bit of the circle. It's overrated in my opinion. So we don't call it waste, used product.
In Italy, if you change the tires, it is already a waste. So you have permission.
But if you do it at home with your own bicycle,
yes,
it's not. So you can bring your bicycle tires to Politecnico. There's a nice container. It's not a waste container. It's made of recycled plastic.
You're right.
I'm an artist, and I don't think the solution of the plastic problem, or it's no problem, but we did design plastic. This is a project to produce a new typology for village, completely può diventare una risorsa. La trasformazione della plastica, in particolare la plastica a mare, è un progetto che ho presentato al gruppo Darius before, che è tuttora diciamo che è stato disatteso e un po' in stand-by. Il mio progetto è di trasformare questi blocchi di plastica, in particolare nei punti più critici, che è la parte orientale della terra, di trasformare in blocchi e costruire delle casette, creare dei piccoli villaggi d'arte. Un villaggio che può essere una forma di economia, perché dei ghetti possono essere trasformati in piccoli musei. I piccoli musei a cielo aperto, a creare bellezza, a creare dei ambienti. Si può creare una microeconomia, si può creare dei posti dove la gente possa interagire con l'arte locale, con la manifattura, piuttosto che l'informazione. Perché come ha parlato la signora Giulia, la cosa importantissima è fondamentale l'informazione. La gente comune non sa, vede un problema, c'è tanta materiale che circola sul problema, sull'internet, sulla plastica. Però il problema non è la plastica, ma è che la gente che la utilizza in modo non corretto, e in particolare paesi non sviluppati, i quali non hanno formazione, non sanno che è un bene, è una risorsa, è una ricchezza tutta sommata, perché comunque esiste da delle possibilità, le possibilità sono infinite se viene dato. Il progetto in particolare, questo plastico, è la trasformazione con questa tipologia di costruire dei blocchi con diversi materiali senza che siano selezionati. Perché la plastica mai è difficilissima se risolviamo, e quindi creare dei blocchi per costruire delle piccole entità, quindi creare dei villaggi, come dicevo prima, che possano essere dei punti di ritrovo, ma che fondamentalmente diventino dei punti di informazione. Informazione per la gente comune, specialmente per i migranti nel tema, non hanno la possibilità di capire qual è il danno che può creare, ma la risorsa che può essere la plastica in questo caso. Quindi questo io cerco di comunicare, quindi di lavorare a livello artistico per comunicare sì, un cambiamento, ma un cambiamento sostenibile è importante. Si parla molto di sostenibilità, però la sostenibilità è importante non solamente il riciclo, ma la separazione, ma anche l'educazione importante di noi stessi, del diritto, il diritto ambientale. Io faccio parte anche come attivista della prima grande progetto della Fondazione Angora, e quindi cerco di portare un messaggio importante attraverso la parte. Grazie.
But I think what you have understood is also really important, the valuation like of the end of life of products. So before they become waste, it's really important that we like understand the real value of the products, and if we manage maybe like to convince companies in making them last a little bit more.
Yeah, for if anyone of you has any question? Yeah, go ahead, please.
Since the life cycle of products is getting shorter and shorter, and it seems difficult to find an actual solution to the problem because of many things, like departments are met by the office, will there be a point where the only way to actually save the planet, or at least tackle and cope with the plastic problem, would be to stop the innovation, to stop the innovation, say, okay, let's stop it. Okay, companies, we know that we make profit out of it, but let's stop it. Like, let's keep a standard, because otherwise
exactly the opposite. Innovation is fundamental to identify the proper solution for companies, people who are engaged in developing new products and new way of doing business. The problem is that the innovation has worked only under certain directives and with certain objectives, which were more related to performance, cost reduction, guarantee of health and safety. Little efforts have been done in looking at the real end of life of the products and how to manage the whole life cycle of a given product, of a given material. So it's exactly the opposite. Innovation is even more important now than it was, because we need to change completely our mind. And the only way you can do it, it's through innovation. You cannot change your mind, you cannot change your approach if you don't introduce innovative way of doing things. We have grown with the concept that there was something that we could take, use, and dispose. This cannot be done anymore. It's not sustainable. Not because we in Italy will have a problem. The whole globe will have a problem. And maybe we in Italy are so lucky and so rich that maybe we will not really feel the impact of what is happening. But if you think that there is a potential growth of the global population from roughly 7 billion people that we are today, in 20, 25 years, there will be 10 billion. And the most growing area is Africa. You can imagine the impact that this will have in terms of needs for food, for water, for good health, for medicines, and so on. And if we not really change our mind in terms of how we use the resources that we have been given, it will be impossible to sustain this demand in the future. I'm working in the plastics industry. I belong to maybe a dirty industry if you look at it under the spotlight that we have today. But I think this perception, this negative perception that has been given to this material, again, is only related to the end of life and the waste that is generated by plastics. But if we really take care and look at what plastics, for example, have done in terms of saving food from becoming waste, I think you will realize that how important, for example, the role of packaging has been in the last 20, 30 years. And packaging mainly is done with plastics. Think about the shelf life of vegetables, meat, cheese, dairies in general, you could not live anymore in the way that our grandfathers and grandmothers used to live, making their shopping every day, just buying something that was necessary for that day. We normally shop for 15 days, sometimes even longer, because there is a good offer in the supermarket. So we buy a 3x2, no? Free portion of coffee that will last maybe 1 year. Now, the shelf life of food is one of the most important results that packaging has given to us, because we'll allow to reduce food waste. And food waste, together with the water waste, are the two most important aspects that will generate potential wars in the next 2 or 3 decades. Water is a scarce resource. There are countries areas in the globe that have limited water availability. And plastics, again, also there can play a very important role to guarantee, first of all, that you can have it, that you can preserve, and that you can distribute. And last but not least, plastics has allowed also, for example, to distribute water, in the agriculture application. You don't see it, because of course nobody of us is really engaged in agriculture on a daily basis, but the most important transport of water is done with plastics. Or you can have this glass of water here in your bath or in the tap, only because behind the wall there is a plastic tube that is bringing the water there. So again, we need to look at the role of plastics on the full picture, not just looking at the end of life. But what is more important is to change our way to approach the consume that we do of our resources, the way that we really use this material and the other materials, because aluminium is again a short material, bauxite, that is the raw material, the feedstock. The Chinese company who have the control of the aluminium on a global basis are going in Ghana, they are going in Africa to buy bauxite mining systems to guarantee the feedstock to produce aluminium for the next future. Okay, but this is also a scarce resource. It's not that we have an infinite quantity of bauxite in the ground. And the same is for glass, the same is for electricity. Again, we are talking about electric vehicle, no? This is the new wave, again, the new wage. To have the batteries, first of all, you need plastics, because batteries are made of plastics, because they put something in a plastic box. You need silicium. Again, there are two or three major places in the world that have this raw material. That's it. So innovation is vital in order to identify the proper solution and not just following the fashion. So what is easy to exchange or easy to identify as the potential solution. Okay. Other questions were from?
Yeah, sure. From one of you or somebody who works in the plastic industry, what do you expect the real impacts to be of legislation like the new European directive that will go into effect in 2021, I believe? What do you expect the real impacts of that legislation or similar legislation to be after?
Of course, the impact will be there. We believe that this directive was generated more for political reasons than for protecting the environment, in specifically the marine litter problem. Of course, it will have an impact mainly in countries like Italy, where the single-use plastics is very common, very diffused. For the simple reason that our area in this country where water is more important and more valuable than other stuff. If you go in Sicily during the summertime, you maybe will understand how water is valuable, and you don't have a dish machine there, so because you don't have water during the day. So the single-use plastics is a solution to guarantee hygiene and the opportunity to use some stuff for your food. The impact will be mainly in Italy, partially in the rest of Europe. Some companies will certainly close their business because they will not have customers anymore. Today I was in Rome, invited in a conference, and for lunch I enjoyed my lasagna in a cellulose dish made in China. And the fork and the knife were in wood made in China. Now, forgetting about the safety and the health problem, so I was really afraid to use them because the guarantee that you have on this material about hygiene, they were just opened on the desk. Say, okay, let's use it, hopefully. But we are moving a business and a material production that is based in Italy and partially in Europe somewhere else, with the excuse that this will reduce the marine litter. Now, if the cellulose dish or the wood fork will end up on a beach, because suddenly I decided to take with me, wait for my summer vacation, and during my summer vacation I will dispose them on the beach, this will not disappear. They will stay there for a while, because cellulose to be used as a, of course, a plastic stuff on top to guarantee that the cellulose does not absorb the liquid. So it will stay not like plastics, but very, very long. So it's not the answer to the marine litter. So coming to your question, for sure it will have an impact. Limited, because the single-use plastics only represent 2-3% of the total demand of plastics in Europe, so it's not so important. But the risk is that what is happening, for example, in Italy, we understood that this directive, which is against the single-use plastics, must be used against the packaging. And packaging has nothing to do with single-use. It's, of course, a single-use by definition, because a packaging can be used only once, made in wood, made in aluminium, made in plastics. By definition, that packaging only works once, but it's not a single use, it's a packaging. The plastic tax is against the packaging, and again, it has nothing to do with the single use. So we have a normal way, the Italian way, I would say, no, to approach what happens in Europe, and we are the only country who is thinking to put a tax on plastics today without really having an environmental footprint, but just, as I said before, a financial interest in this. Moderatore.
Yeah, non solo a me, I have a question first. I mean, you said, for all of you, you said before that we need to act.
Yes.
And you talk about consumption, ethical consumption, and so on. So, how do you see, or maybe how will consumer behavior affect this transition?
Let's start from there, and I answer again.
Yeah, I think it is important the role of final consumers to change the company's behavior to produce. Longer end of life product. That is for sure.
Però è vero anche che ultimamente le grandi companies comunque stanno un po' investendo sulla responsabilità sociale, quindi anche il loro modo di comunicarsi, di fare educazione interna sta un po' prendendo una piega diversa. Quello che mi veniva in mente mentre stava parlando prima è che un libro che ho letto un po' di anni fa era di una scrittrice dello Sri Lanka che racconta che quando è arrivata in America è arrivata in un centro commerciale e la cosa incredibile era che lei poteva allungare la mano e prendere tutto quello che voleva senza, con una facilità incredibile. Questo credo sia una brutta abitudine che abbiamo noi. Io sono cresciuta con le bottiglie di vetro, veniva il signore a casa a ritirare la cassetta e mi ricordo che quando siamo passati alla plastica tutti avevano urlato all'allarme che sembrava fosse cancerogena perché non eravamo abituati. In realtà poi penso a come sia stato facile in realtà passare da un comportamento ad un altro, abituarci ad un comportamento poco funzionale rispetto a quello che avevamo prima. È una questione culturale, va goccia a goccia cambiato, però io credo e spero che, almeno rispetto all'esperienza che stiamo avendo noi con le grandi, con delle grandi società e delle grandi companies che ci stanno appunto chiamando per aiutarle a sviluppare dei progetti di economia circolare, all'interno che trasformino quindi i loro scarti, io credo ci sia una piccola apertura adesso che è la motivazione principale, e questo io me lo pongo come domanda io per prima, sia la visibilità, la comunicazione, la possibilità, questo non lo so. So solo che si stanno cominciando a parlare di cose di cui fino ad ora non si era ancora parlato, o almeno io non ho mai sentito parlare. La lancio così e la lascio un po' come tema di riflessione.
I see consumers, in the case I reflect on myself as somebody who can change, but just by little bits. I don't think that from one day to the other we can all change something substantially. But these small changes, and certainly if we talk about the circular process, we have a very big mechanism of an industrial circle, is very hard to break. In my opinion, this should be done in smaller circles. So in each step of the circular economy, have something visual, have something touchable by hands even, by the consumer, so they can attach to it. That's something that I can do. That's something that attracts my attention, or that's something that comes automatically. It can be by water houses, water points, in the case of plastic bottles, that might change the attention of the consumer from the machine with the plastic bottles to, hey, there's the water tap, maybe I can reuse my plastic bottle or bring an aluminium bottle. Or the small changes, I think, on the end will have a more snowball effect than trying to reach for a very big change as a plastic tax on the general behavior of consumers.
So you believe more on like people commitment rather than, I don't know, an economic policy?
I think that the change in general should come from all sides, that includes policies that needs to be changed, that includes European directions on circular economy, but the most effective on consumer behavior is not Europe that says do this or do that, but the little changes.
Well, there were some questions before. Yeah. You
in ordine alfabetico.
Sì, let's say that companies can find a solution for innovation, but of course they need investments, so they have money. What would be of the producers, suppliers of plastics that do this innovation? So part of the industry will be
Okay, first of all, the supply chain. No risk that the plastic industry will disappear. So whatever it's the concept of people who believe that there is a potential world where we can be plastic free, forget it. No way. No way, because innovation, evolution will lead for an increase of plastic demand, not for a decrease, okay? For sure, everyone that have bought this nice aluminum stuff had a packaging maybe with it. So probably we had already a plastic something used together with the aluminum bottle. The concept of innovation is related to the way that the system is working. It's not just one single industry that has to change. It's the whole value chain, starting from the raw material, the feedstock, which we of course take from the ground, until the management of the waste when a product has arrived at the end of its life. I have no doubt that plastic will still exist, will still be there. The quantity will increase by the level that I said before, for the simple fact that it's not replaceable. And every alternative material that is in front of plastics will lose. If we take, for example, transparency, how many materials you know that are transparent? Only two. And one is glass. So if you want something transparent, just watch up there. If you want the lights and you need something transparent, or you do in plastics or you do in glass. If you want something which is light, if you think what the PET bottle with 20, 25 grams is able to support, if you go in the backyard of supermarket where they receive the food stuff and the water stuff, so the bottles, you will see a pallet with hundreds of bottles and then another pallet on top of it and then another pallet on top of it. Means that the bottle which is on the bottom, it's a supporting 20, 30, 50 kilograms in a single bottle, which is 25 grams. There is no other alternatives that can do at the same level of weight this performance. So from this perspective, I have no doubts, and I'm not alone in this, luckily, that the future for plastic will still be bright. The problem is how we manage plastics at the end of life and how we innovate the way that we use plastics and we produce our goods in order to guarantee that we reduce the waste, we reuse the product when can be reused, and finally, we recycle it. And plastics is the most recyclable material, the easiest one. The problem is when you have maybe material which are non-monomaterial, so you have multi-material stuff. And now it's on fashion to have, when you go to the grocery for your bread, they give you a nice paper bag with a wonderful plastic window, you know, so you can see what they are putting in it. But if I said I want that, there is no risk to change, you know, you put that piece of bread in my bag. Why do I need this plastic window? It's useless. And this becomes a problem when we arrive at the end of life, because it's not paper, it's not plastics. Where do I put it? How do I recycle it? And it will be a problem or for the plastic value chain or for the paper value chain. So we need to design and think about the use we make of the material in order to avoid this kind of small mistakes that we can do on our daily life. Regarding the supply chain, the plastics industry is managed on a global basis by multinational, very strong and big companies. They have finance, they have competence, they have knowledge, so they will be not at risk. And it's very unlikely that people who are in the downstream will really look at the upstream, because to make plastics and to make it valuable, you don't invent it on a day, just one day to another. Okay, so from that perspective, I don't see this as a real issue. What can be important is the role of the brand owners that have a role on the consumer behavior, have a role in designing the material, they have a role in designing the packaging, and they have a role in the whole value chain. When Coca-Cola decided to move away from glass to PET, they changed our world. Because Coca-Cola use, I don't know, something like 300 to 400 million, 30 to 35 million tons of plastic packaging. So you can imagine the impact that the decision made by this company has had on our daily behavior. They can influence, of course, the consumer behavior, but vice versa, the consumer recycling that bottle can influence the future of that bottle. If they are collected and recycled, we can go on and use and reuse that product again in a new life. I don't know if I answered your question. Sorry? Ah, yes. Regarding the cost, of course, we are in a market today where we in Italy, in Europe, have a standard of living, which is, of course, very, very nice, even if we complain and moan every day, but we have no problem to drink, to eat, to warm up, to have a car, and so on. But of course, when it comes to material, when it comes to designing, this cannot be the same all over the world. There is a need to identify solutions that are capable to be competitive. Today, using the materials that we have available, they are competitive. One of the reasons that has made the plastic so successful, displacing all the other materials, is the cost. A plastic bottle costs nothing, basically, no? In terms of real cost. Maybe company who are selling mineral water, they spend more for advertising than they spend for the plastic bottle. But it represents a solution that can become diffused because it's convenient in terms of cost competitiveness. The same will apply for the new solutions that will be found by the industry to resolve the circularity and to make recyclable or manageable the end of life of the products. So from that perspective, I'm sure they will be competitive.
Would you like to add something? There are any questions?
Meglio, e penso che qualcuno che potesse usare anche la componente di insomma l'intera rivoluzione moderna. Volevo capire in che modo, cioè, diciamo, proprio con questa tappa che operate, cioè se progettate l'arma delle stampate voi successivamente piace, oppure se riuscite a trovare la materia prima, e poi viene progetto da là che possono stamparsi da loro stessi. E volevo chiedere se questa, in particolare questa parte di possono utilizzare diciamo, un mezzo per anche con la creazione di altri oggetti, se alla comunque molto bene alla base c'è un altro plastico.
Esatto, allora tutti gli oggetti che vengono stampati con gli stampa 3D sono ideati e creati da un team di designers interni. Quindi abbiamo due ragazzi che collaborano con noi e che sono esperti di modellazione e creazione, per cui viene tutto creato al nostro interno. Noi abbiamo 6 stampanti 3D che viaggiano continuamente. L'utilizzo della stampa 3D quindi è tutto fatto internamente. Noi gestiamo l'intero ciclo, quindi gestiamo lo scarto, facciamo lo studio di fattibilità sul biopolimero, creiamo la bioplastica e a quel punto la utilizziamo per stampare oggetti di design. Con la stampante 3D si può stampare qualsiasi cosa. Il bello di questa tecnologia è proprio il fatto che per chi si occupa di design, architettura, comunque tutte le materie un po' più creative, liberano la creatività, per cui si possono pensare delle forme, delle grandezze che con i processi di stampa tradizionali della plastica, quindi con gli stampi, non è possibile immaginare. è un mondo veramente bellissimo e fa parte appunto di questa che viene chiamata l'industria 4.0. E poi secondo me, rispetto a quello che abbiamo detto fino ad ora, è un modo di produrre in maniera responsabile, proprio per ricondurci poi al tema che è stato il fil rouge un po' di tutta questa discussione. È la produzione responsabile perché viene stampato solo il necessario, quindi senza sovrapproduzione di stock e quindi senza quella necessità poi di dover smaltire a fine vita il rifiuto e tutta quante le problematiche di cui abbiamo parlato. Quindi sì, è una tecnologia che permette la stampa di qualsiasi cosa in qualsiasi momento e gli oggetti sono molto belli perché sono perfetti, cioè vengono stampati in un'unica soluzione e non hanno giunture, punti di rottura. È interessante, davvero interessante come processo. C'era qualcos'altro a cui non avevo risposto?
No, però so sapere se potrebbe essere in futuro il fatto che comunque una tecnologia abbastanza a basso costo la stampante della dice. Può essere diciamo, un modo per ricaricare il trasporto di
allora, cioè, esatto. In modo che la gente possa poi perfetto, sì.
Autoprodursi disponibile le scarpe in Sud America senza dover trasportare le scarpe o trasportare l'Africa.
Hai centrato perfettamente il problema, cioè questa la nostra vision è quella proprio di creare una rete di stampanti, quindi una fabbrica diffusa che abbia stampanti in tutto il mondo. Per cui, dato che la bioplastica comunque, o almeno quella basilare, poi la parte di arricchimento è un altro discorso, però è presente in tutti i paesi, si può produrre vicino al consumatore utilizzando la stampante più vicina al consumatore. Questa è la nostra, diciamo, l'obiettivo attendere, quindi sì, alla fine quello che viaggia è un file che può essere spedito e quindi si può stampare vicino al consumatore. Questo è un po' quello che noi stiamo cercando di arrivare. Quindi per ridurre, non il chilometro zero, però ha ridotto l'impatto ambientale rispetto appunto al trasporto. Grazie a te.
Supporting these type of activities and also giving the possibility of repairing pieces or bulk shops or these type of things. Also like legislation or also supporting complete projects and activities.
So first of all, in terms of bulk product or loose supply, again, this was a model of living that was used by my grandfather and my grandmother when they on a daily basis were using to buy 50 grams of coffee, 200 grams of flour, maybe just a piece of bread and things like this. Without any guarantee in terms of shelf life, hygiene, control of the raw material and so on. So having a track on the production lot and so on. Today, this is impossible. We have made in this country so many developments in terms of guaranteeing the consumers regarding even the source of the meat, knowing the name of the cow which was grown in a farm in Piacenza, Italy, no? And we know we put a stamp that gives us the knowledge of the name of the cow. If it is loose, it's a cow coming from maybe Poland, Hungary, Argentina, whoever knows. So it's just a basic example to say, yes, we can go to Lush and buy some shampoo in powder and make our shampoo in this way. Good luck if you can use it. I still prefer something which is easy to buy and to manage. But the problem is not to have a loose stuff or to buy something which is without packaging. Again, it is in the behavior that we have versus that packaging. If we are responsible in managing the end of life of that material, this is already a solution. It's a proper way of managing something which can become a problem, and instead of being a problem for someone, it's a resource for someone else. Can be a lump, can be a pile, can be another plastic stuff, can be anything else, provided we really give a second chance to that material to be reused or to be recycled. The other question regarding what Confindustria or the companies, the value chain is doing. Of course, the whole value chain is engaged in trying to identify solution to the issue that we are facing, which is mainly related to the end of life of plastic stuff. And of course, the most important evolution today is to promote the concept of recyclability. Move as much as possible away from products, goods, who are difficult or even not possible to recycle, to product and goods who can be recyclable. Something which is recyclable, not necessarily it's recycled, okay? This is also important because there is a list of things to do to move from recyclable to recycle. But at least the industry is already engaged in moving more and more from goods who are non-recyclable to goods who are recyclable. Then it's up to us to make it recycled. And this is part of the consumer behavior, for example. If we do not make a separate collection of our plastic stuff, even if it is recyclable like a plastic bottle, it will not be recycled because it's ending up somewhere else. So this is an important stuff. Other projects are in place, for example, when it comes to plastic cups. Again, here, there is a project to reuse the plastic cups and to make them recycled in order to have a circular approach to the plastic cups that we use for our daily coffee at the vending machine. And again, this is a project which is starting, which has started, sorry, a few months ago, and we will learn more in the near future.
Well, I think Politecnico is trying to kick us out of the room because I see people outside.
Okay.
Clean, but there was like a question. So
I don't know if you asked. My question is, how far we are from the decision to recycle a good fraction of the plastic waste, at least in Italy?
If we talk about plastic packaging, we are at a very good level. Today, we recycle in Italy more or less 1 million tons of plastic packaging in terms of material recovery. And another, I would say 500,000 tons, 600,000 tons are recovered in terms of energy. So means that more than 80% of plastic packaging in this country today are recovered, either recycled as material or under energy. Of course, a lot still has to be done. Industry is engaged, Italian industries are engaged. And one most very important innovation that will come in the next 5 years is the chemical recycling. Again, it's something new in terms of concept. It's something that the chemical industry and the plastics industry will definitely approach. And in 5 years' time, I'm sure you will not hear anymore about plastic problem, because the plastics industry will enter with the chemical recycling to resolve most of the non-recyclable plastic issue that we have today.
If you want to share with us any thoughts, or maybe I would
just like to make the distinction, the last point, between industrial, something that's has to be low cost and produced in big amounts, and industrious. And I brought an example of a belt. It's not that I want to sell the belt. The point of the project is that it's a circular project, which is handmade. Industrious means also constant, means regularly. It means keeping people occupied, which means work. It's on a smaller scale, but it's a project, it's a product that is retraceable with a number, not of a cow, but of a piece of a bicycle tire in this case. But it can be other projects, it can be other products that are being recycled. So think also in different scales of this circularity, in an industrious scale, in a hand-based scale, in a design-based scale as well.
Io volevo aggiungere un'ultima cosa, un esempio concreto di quello che stiamo facendo, un po' per concludere, anche per poi completare la risposta di prima. Per Autogrill, per esempio, stiamo trasformando le bucce d'arancia, quelle proprio delle spremute, quelle che utilizzano delle spremute, e le stiamo trasformando utilizzando tecnologie di stampa 3D, ad esempio degli sgabelli di bioplastica arricchita con questo polimero. Perché la possibilità di arricchire il PLA con questo biopolimero dà anche la possibilità di ottenere della materiale che ha anche le stesse caratteristiche dello scarto con cui viene generata, per cui in questo caso la morbidezza dell'arancio, oppure quando utilizziamo i fondi di caffè, l'aroma del caffè. Quindi questo era giusto per dare un po' un'idea un po' più concreta in realtà di quello che stiamo facendo e di quello che stiamo portando avanti, delle possibilità che si possono avere con la stampa 3D.
It is fast, yes, because they force me to conclude as soon as possible.
Questo materiale che mi ha detto è riciclabile,
è riciclabile, certo. Sì, è biodegradabile, certo. Sempre io non voglio.
Parliamone.
Adesso ho paura, è biodegradabile.
Parliamone.
Però poi lo dico con un po' di timore.
Mi astengo da commenti. È sicuramente riciclabile, però bisogna vedere che cosa si intende per riciclabile. The concept of recyclable is a very complex one. Material are easy to recycle and are easy to say that they are recyclable. Goods are more complex. Okay, if you put together aluminum and plastics, they are both material perfectly recyclable. You put them together, you have an issue. Okay, someone has resolved the issue, but you have an issue. And the same is if you put the PLA, so the polylactic acid, with something else. Not necessarily this means that these two materials will be easy to biodegrade or to make them compostable. And to make them recyclable, you need to collect them. So someone needs to put them in a bin. That bin should go somewhere in a semi-industry or somewhere where people will really recycle it. So not easy to say that it's recyclable.
Just the last question.
Assolutamente no. Il Tetra Pak, Tetra Pak or Tetra Brick is definitely a perfect solution when you have a special product like milk or juice and so on, because the value of the packaging is in line with the value of the goods. But if we talk about water, it's just a nonsense to spend energy to produce the aluminum foil. Plastic to make the plastic foil and paper to make the bulk of the container, when easily you can have a PET bottle, which is cheaper, easy to produce and less environmental impact. And last but not least, recyclable.
Okay, guys. So, no more
questions,
right?
Basta.
Thank you very much.
Grazie. Fate morire, ragazzi. Grazie a voi.